I'm Ian Weinstein. I want to start by also thanking Sam and Joy for giving me this opportunity to write and talk with you about the crisis in access to civil justice for low and moderate income Americans. It's obviously such an important topic. I want to give a shout out to Joy and to the clinical program at the University of Tennessee. Some of you may know that is one of the longest and richest traditions of law school clinics providing legal services to the poor. It's a fabulous program. And of course, I have to thank Sam, who was my teacher, and actually my wife and I both took labor law from Sam.
I take credit for all his successes and his wife's.
He has long been for me a model of an outstanding academic who is also deeply engaged with the bar in practice. Now, my topic is what we know, and also I should say what we don't know. And I don't know if I'm the best person to talk about what we do know, but given how I stumble around, I hope I can offer something about what we don't know in this important area. I don't want to get all epistemological on you and talk about what it means to know, but I do want to give a nod to the very important slogan that obviously there are many different ways of knowing a huge social phenomenon like the crisis in access to justice. We heard Justice Hecht comment on the lack of hard data from Texas. I'll say a word more about that later in my presentation, but I want to say his comment reflects how really fragmentary our knowledge is, how difficult it is to find really reliable data, particularly at the national level. And just as a teaser, I want to let you know that about two-thirds of the way through my talk, I'm going to reveal to you a national statistic central to this discussion that I don't believe has been revealed elsewhere based on quite recent data. So keep your attention for
Stay
that.
Tuned.
Yeah, yeah. Now, obviously, my account is going to be largely descriptive. What are the needs? What are the resources? What gets left out? What's unmapped? But before I describe, I want to offer two distinctly normative propositions. The first one is a point Sam made to me early in the work we did together on the chapter about what we know. This is a really big problem. By any reading of the data, every year, tens of millions of middle and low-income Americans, I'll say more about this group, have significant legal problems but do not engage with the civil justice system. While some probably do make a free and informed choice to avoid the law, many cannot access the civil justice system for lack of counsel because of the technical challenges, the very sophisticated legal issues they face, as Professor Noel talked about. Of the millions who do engage, many go unrepresented or struggle mightily to pay legal fees. And low and moderate income Americans are also overrepresented in specialized courts like landlord-tenant courts, like family courts, like lower civil courts, where dockets are especially heavy, lawyers are very scarce, and where we clearly are not meeting our aspirations to civil justice. And I can't resist noting that this is in stark contrast to the experience that wealthier Americans have when they have a legal problem and access the civil justice system. Their problems are quite often resolved in better resource courts with the assistance of counsel, and of course they have access to the whole burgeoning system of private dispute resolution. I also note to you huge geographic variation with much greater availability of legal services lawyers in some parts of the country than in other places. So for all the problems that we have talked about and will talk about, it's important to note very significant geographic variation. We're really far from our aspirations to equal civil justice for all. The second thing I want to observe before I go into the description is that in the last 7 years or so, there's been a really significant and beneficial increase in attention to this problem from many courts, from some other political actors, from a vigorous group of advocates and analysts. I can't resist giving a shout out to the work of Judge Littman here in New York, the task force he created. I'd also note here in New York the Immigrant Representation Project, to cite some local examples, the national work of the ABA and the Department of Justice's Access to Justice Project. These are all really important initiatives. There's also a revival in the academic literature in this area. There's been a tremendous amount of work, has already been said, and we're going to learn quite a bit more, I think, today and tomorrow, about assisting pro se litigants to navigate in courts. And here in New York, it does seem important to me to note that under Judge Lipman's leadership, we actually saw an increase in funding for civil legal services, an increase in the number of people served in New York, something like 50,000 additional instances of representation last year, and how really significant that is. This is such a dynamic area, full of initiatives and energy. All right, let me turn to the descriptive part, what the data tells us about the scope of this problem, okay? Now, I want to offer you my best effort at an overall national picture, and it's going to require some lawyer's math. Lawyer's math, you may know, is even less reliable than lawyer's history, so I have to urge you to view what I'm saying with a critical eye, but there is really very little by way of national level data, and I hope that this will be a useful overview and help to frame the problem. Okay, first we can talk about legal needs. And there is, as many in the room know, a fairly strong tradition, a robust literature on legal needs that goes back to the 1970s and work done by Barbara Curran. More recently, Deborah Rohde and Rebecca Sandifer analyzing Curran's work and successor work by the ABA indicate that about half the legal needs of moderate-income Americans and perhaps 80% of the legal needs of low-income Americans are unmet by the civil justice system. And as we dig into that picture, what we see are surveys of Americans that show that about half of all low and moderate-income American households experience a non-trivial civil legal problem each year. Now, the work done by Rebecca Sandifer suggests that there are about 44 million low and moderate income households, there are about 100 million Americans in those households who experience what the literature calls a non-trivial civil legal problem each year. Poor people tend to experience more legal problems per household, and overall, half the problems do end up in the civil justice system. That estimate is generally in line with the observation that there are about 22 million civil actions filed in American courts in 2013. What that tells us is that there are on the order of 20 million or perhaps 22 million non-trivial legal problems that never go to court, right? These are folks whose legal problems simply remain outside of the civil justice system, and that is not even considering the vast needs in transactional and planning matters for people of low and moderate income. So why do these folks not even engage with the system? Availability of lawyers is clearly one important factor, the literature says, but there are a number of other important factors. I note work by Albertson, Krister, Hatfield, who's been mentioned, and some others that paint a rather complex picture that people report that they feel that engaging with the civil legal system won't change the outcome. They say they prefer to handle it for themselves. And it does appear that Americans are somewhat more likely to forego the benefits of the civil justice system than citizens of other nations. But we really know very little about that group. This is an area in which there's a tremendous need for additional research. What we do know is that 20 million or more American households, perhaps 50 million Americans, have legal problems and do not go to the law. And I have to say that I am quite reluctant to conclude that these are folks who are making a real free choice not to engage with the law. I am really, by practice area, a criminal defense lawyer. And so I have a feeling for what it's like to work in a system in which people are guaranteed counsel. And everybody knows that the lawyers you get in criminal cases vary greatly in their attention to the cases. Nonetheless, the incidence of pro se representation is quite low in that setting. It's just an anecdotal observation. There's actually good data that shows that people very rarely turn down an offer of counsel that they can easily afford when they perceive that person to be competent. So I think there are many unanswered questions and much that we need to know about the 20 or 22 million households, the 50 million Americans or more, who simply do not engage with the civil justice system every year despite having significant legal problems. Okay, now I want to talk a little bit about the cases that do go to court, okay? Again, putting aside all the transactional and planning legal needs folks have, okay? And say a word building up from some overall court statistics. We know from data collected by the National Center on State Courts that there are about 95 million cases filed in American courts in 2013. That was a dip from the post-recession high of just over 100 million cases. More than half of them, you'll be interested to know, or perhaps not, are traffic cases. 51 million, put those aside, not our focus, and another 20 million are criminal cases. Less than 2 million are juvenile cases, leaving about 22 million civil cases as the National Center on State Courts counts the cases. Obviously, this bird's eye view eliminates a lot of important texture, but I think it's useful for our purposes. Of those 22 million civil cases that get to our courts, that's a 2013 number, recent data from a study of more than 150 courts in 10 large counties selected as representative suggests that in a quarter of the cases, both sides have counsel, okay? That's from a publication called The Landscape of Civil Litigation, 2015 publication also of the National Center on State Courts. So, in that group of 5.5 million cases, in excess of 11 million parties, given that there are at least two parties in each case, right? That includes all of the litigation, that is litigation where one business is suing another business. That includes all of the litigation in which people of means are able to hire lawyers, and some portion of the 2.5 to 3 million people who are served by legal services and pro bono attorneys in America, okay? So I'd ask you please to remember those 11 million people who are represented by lawyers, because we're gonna come back to those 11 million people and say a word about what we know and what we don't know about them.
Just Ian, what number of cases does this, you said there were 95 million cases filed in 2013.
Right, 95 million
20
cases.
20 million of them are criminals, that's 75 million.
22 million civil actions is a good number for the overall civil justice docket in America.
And you're saying in half of those cases, both sides are represented?
In a quarter of those cases. In a quarter of those cases, and I'm getting to the statistic I promised you, which I think is an addition to the discussion. Okay?
Thank you.
So in a quarter of those cases, both sides are represented, right? So in the remaining three quarters of the cases, that's 16.5 million cases nationally, at least one party is pro se, at least one party is unrepresented. In some number of those cases, both parties are unrepresented. The data doesn't really break that out, although there's a way I'm gonna suggest that we can get a little insight into this, okay? And here, I think, is what was for me the most striking thing to come out of this publication from the National Center on State Courts, is how dramatically the number of unrepresented litigants has risen. So, the National Center for State Courts reports that in 1992, okay, 95% of cases had two lawyers, okay? Today, the number is obviously much lower. 92% of plaintiffs have lawyers, and only nationally, 26% of defendants, okay? This, as far as I know, folks may know of data that I haven't found in my work, is the first national level data offering hard numbers for the often made assertion that pro se cases have risen dramatically. Certainly the numbers suggest that. So, just to try and paint this picture a little bit more, we end up with 3/4 of defendants and about 10% of all plaintiffs unrepresented by this method, right? That's on the order of 18.5 million pro se litigants nationally. According to this data set, there was a pro se litigant in less than 7% of the cases in the early 90s, and today there are pro se litigants in 3/4 of the cases. Now, the number I am presenting to you this evidence of what seems to be a very significant increase. I want to make clear to you the 18.5 million number of unrepresented litigants in our civil justice system in 2013 is an extrapolation because, as I commented, the data is so fragmentary. Some states report total numbers of unrepresented litigants, many states don't. California reports on the order of 4 million unrepresented litigants in its courts. In New York, through the work of the task force, now Commission on Access to Justice, New York reported about 1.8 million unrepresented litigants last year. That was down from over 2 million about 4 years ago. Among the largest court systems, and certainly we all know that everything is big in Texas, it is, after all, a state with a large population. We don't know what the number is, based on population and what we know about other states, it seems to me the number has to be in the range of 3 million unrepresented. These are, guesstimates, these are very big numbers. What we also know about the unrepresented or pro se litigants is that we see many more of them in particular kinds of cases. So it won't surprise anybody in this room to hear that the data bears out. People are quite often unrepresented in family law matters, there is a so-called asymmetry of counsel in landlord-tenant cases. To put that in plain speech, landlords very often have lawyers, tenants very infrequently have lawyers, and of course landlords have repeat player lawyers. Consumer debt cases, another group of cases where plaintiffs are often represented, defendants much less frequently represented. So far, I've talked with you about legal needs. I've suggested to you that about half the low and moderate income people who have non-trivial legal problems simply do not engage the justice system. The half that do engage the justice system, there has been a tremendous rise in the incidence of unrepresented litigants in the civil justice system. I want to talk a bit about the supply and distribution of lawyers and talk a bit about the people who are represented. So remember, perhaps I asked you to keep in mind the 11 million or so parties represented in the cases in which both parties have a lawyer. I could step through the math with you, but maybe I'll save that in case folks have a question for me about it. But suffice it to say that those 11 million plus the folks who are represented in all of the cases in which one party is represented, we come to about 25.5 million represented parties in the civil justice system. Well, that's a big number, and that sounds pretty good, but when you start to break that down, what you see is that legal services, legal aid, pro bono, all of the various sources of free or extremely low cost representation probably get us about 3 to 4 million of those representations. By my math, there are on the order of, and I'm just trying to give you an overall picture, about 20 million civil litigants hire lawyers in the marketplace. And I have to say that this is really the great terra incognita here. We know that the private bar provides the lion's share of legal services to moderate income Americans through fee-generating cases. Jillian Hatfield, who's already been mentioned, has done work on the allocation of legal services through the marketplace, the data is quite fragmentary. Obviously, some of those litigants are wealthy individuals, although we know it's a small slice. Some of those litigants are businesses. Based on Hatfield's work, perhaps a quarter of the group is individuals who are not in the top 2 or 3% of income in America. I can say why that's my guess if anybody wants to talk about that in the question session. But what all this says is that millions of Americans, probably on the order of 5 to 10 million American households with moderate incomes, hire lawyers in the marketplace. Now, some of those are contingency and other fee-shifting situations, but we really don't know. We do know that the largest source of legal services for moderate income Americans, right? And here I'm using the term to indicate for all of those folks who cannot meet the needs test, right, for legal services, legal aid style representation, right? The largest source of legal services is clearly the private bar and the marketplace. We just know very, very little about, we know so little about the litigants in that sphere. We know so little about the deals they make with their lawyers. And we know very little about the lawyers who represent people in that part of the marketplace and in those cases, what their practices look like, what kind of dockets they carry, how they make a living, and so on. And that's why I say to you that is really the great terra incognita, the great unknown land. Right now, it's a map and it says there be dragons. That's something we certainly need to know quite a lot more about. So, if 44 million low and moderate income households have a significant legal problem in a year, there are more than 22 million of them who simply do not engage with the civil justice system. We need to know a lot more about that group. Of the 22 million cases and roughly 45 million parties in those cases, obviously some of the litigants are not low or moderate income individuals, but they're better resourced adversaries in litigation who are often represented by repeat player counsel. Somewhere in the range of 5 to 10 million of those litigants struggle in varying degrees to find and afford a lawyer in the private marketplace. I've suggested to you that that is territory we know almost nothing about and seems like such important territory for us to understand. Certainly, I think that is at the core of Sam's insight as to why this book and this project are so important to meeting the vast need. because you look at the numbers and there's no way around it, that's where a lot the action is. Of course, we all know that there are a distinct and pressing set of problems for the 3 to 4 million folks who receive legal services at very low or no cost. I heard someone here already use the number, and it's certainly the case from the legal services data that for every person who is served, at least one person is turned away, given what we know about the number of people who simply do not even seek to engage. There's reason to think that there's a whole other very significant group of folks who never even seek counsel. They're all part of that unmet need. I hope that this is this bird's eye view and all these numbers have provided some useful framing of this. As I said, Sam said to me early in my work on this project, this is just a really big problem. And as you look at the numbers, it is very, very hard to think that we cannot do better.
Thank you, Ian. It's a terrific overview.